Hello everyone, welcome to WIMPS Live. Today we're in the Black Box in Belfast. I'm the coach for Belfast Central Crew. My name's Mickey. Tonight is hosted by our West Belfast Crew. This is Community Relations Week, and tonight we are our theme is expressing identity and addressing diversity.
We have three panels discussing three different issues that has gone on in the past months. Later we'll discuss flags and protests and how young people are portrayed in the media and social media.
Now we're going to start with new communities arriving in Northern Ireland. Whether it be from Poland or Africa or Asia, are they treated as long-standing communities and as well as they should be? And can they express their identity and diversity and bring something we celebrate? I'm going to ask the panel to introduce themselves, starting with Melissa.
Yes, hello everybody. I'm Melissa, I'm from Italy, and I'm here in Belfast to do an experience as EVS, European volunteer. And I will stay here until this summer. And I was working this year in WIMPS and public achievement. So this experience for me is quite new because I was abroad to have some other studies experiences, but this one is different because I'm working, and so I'm inside, I'm more involved in the society here in Belfast. I was welcomed very well from the people here, and this was quite new in comparison to other experiences in the past. And so that could be also about the fact that I'm working with some young people in their areas, in their communities, and I can share many things also with the people that I'm working with.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Liz. I'm American, as you probably figured out. I have been living in Belfast for 4.5 years now, and I actually was lucky enough to come to Belfast as a volunteer at Public Achievement, where I was for 3.5 years. I came here, well, it's not really a simple answer when people ask me, you know, what on earth are you doing here? Because the short answer is I came for a man, but that's not really the full answer, and I don't really like to use that one anyway. I came as a volunteer, and then I studied here as well, so I have some experience kind of, you know, within the education system, and now I'm just here working, trying to live my life here. I think people, a lot of times when they find out that you're from somewhere else, they kind of go, oh, don't you miss home, don't you, you know, whatever, and I do, but at the same time, my life is here, so I don't really think about home as a place where I'm missing the things that I do every day. I don't know, that probably didn't make a lot of sense. But there was a comment actually before we started about from someone who said that they don't feel like they have an identity here because they don't belong in either of the two communities. And that was something that I really identified with because I struggle with that every day. My partner is from a certain community. I live in a certain community here as it's traditionally defined. But where am I? Where's my place? How do I express any kind of political identity in a place where I'm not seen to have any ownership really over what's happened and what's happening? So that's just something that that I think about quite a lot, just as a thought to throw out there for everyone.
Hi, I'm Karen. I'm from West Belfast, and I am the coach for the WIMPS Crew in West Belfast. I'm currently an undergraduate politics student at Queen's, and I've been involved in community work the last 5 years or so, and hope to do it professionally. And a big issue for me is about identity and things like that will probably be discussed throughout the night, and also the relation of how people fit in different ways and how you can have multiple identities and how this kind of fits in the traditional kind of boundary of what we think of as the traditional two communities, but also that, you know, other people from other communities here who've lived here just as long and don't really get the recognition. So hopefully we'll discuss the issues around that tonight.
Good evening. My name is Michael O'Flaherty. I'm the Chief Commissioner of the Northern Ireland Human Rights Commission, and I'm an outsider too. I came up from the South 2 years ago, my first time to live in Northern Ireland. And so I can speak, I think, as an outsider, and I can speak of an overwhelming welcome. I felt fantastically welcomed here. And I think that's the experience of the vast majority of people who arrive in Northern Ireland. It's generally a good news story. It's also a good news story for Northern Ireland. You'd be surprised to discover that on average, immigrant children, new arrivals from abroad, do better in school than people who've lived here all their lives. Now that's a remarkable fact. It's only a few statistical points above, but they do better in school than the kids who've gone through the whole system in Northern Ireland. Now, good news like that doesn't mask the bad news. There's also really serious problems. In the last year, there have been 750 racist incidents reported by the police in Northern Ireland. That's bigger than the year before, that's bigger than the year before that. That's far too much for a small place with a population of less than 2 million. And what are those racist incidents? Just to put a face on them. I spent a morning with a Polish couple in Antrim last year. I spent it with them in their darkened living room. The curtains were drawn. Somebody had put a nail bomb on their window. It didn't go off, but they were afraid, never mind not to go out of the house, they were afraid to open the curtains because of what might happen to them. You can speak to many other groups. I spoke to people from East Timor, Timor-Leste, who get sick because they felt unwelcome in doctors' practices. Just a couple of weeks ago with Roma people here in Belfast, who are living in appalling conditions because of this discriminatory treatment they experience from landlords. So there are real problems. There's an awful lot to be done. And maybe later on tonight, we can talk a bit about what we actually could do.
Okay, thank you. If anyone on Twitter wants to get involved, you can tweet with the hashtag WIMPSLive. Just a question for the panel, probably for you, Liz. Being here for 4 years, did you feel welcomed when you arrived? Do you feel that you are part of the community? Do you fit in?
I think, well, that's not, there's no easy answer for that. Yes, I felt welcomed, but I was lucky because I came here to join someone who, you know, is a local, you might say. Yeah. So, you know, I had his friends and his family who had no choice but to welcome me, really. And so I was lucky that way. Do I feel part of the community? I mean, that's an interesting question because I suppose that's, what do you mean by community? Whose community? Which community? At what different point in my life? I mean, you know, there's a community where I work. I'm part of that. I don't really feel part of the community that I live in, like physically where my house is. I suppose I've kind of spent 4 years building my own community. But I do think it takes a long time, and something that I've noticed is that it took, I think, about 2 years until I really felt like I had my own friends. And I don't know if that's something that that other people who have moved here would agree with, but I think there's a difference in the level of feeling welcomed, yes, and that no one was, you know, outwardly really rude to me except for people who really disagree with American politics and wanted to tell me so, and there were plenty of those. But there's a difference between that and moving to a new place and actually making real friends in that sense. So I suppose it depends on the day and the place. And I know that that's a very confused answer, but that's the best I have for you.
Thank you. For me anyway, personally I feel that in Northern Ireland we tend to, I don't know if for a search for a better word, embrace Americans rather than people from the rest of Europe, people from other parts of the world. Melissa's from Italy. Do you want to say a bit about, like, coming from Italy, do you feel that because you are European, you're welcomed a lot more, or do you feel discriminated against?
No, I felt really welcomed here. Usually it's not really curious to have a person from Italy because Italians are everywhere. In every place you go, you find some Italian people, also some little community of Italians. So it's not really that the people has always many questions about, because it's a place common for the food, pizza, mafia, mandolino, these kind of things. And for me, it was interesting that many people, also if they are surrounded by Italians, they were so curious about me. And this make me also think about how I was in some way lucky, because some people that maybe come from other countries, they don't have the same treatment because they are from other countries. And I don't know why, maybe the Italian people are they seem to be, I don't know, funny or something. They are always a good welcome. Oh, really? Are you from Italy? It's amazing. But why is not the same for some other countries? I don't know, maybe it's because it's something that you don't know exactly about the culture of some other things. And from Italy, more or less, you can know or about politics problems or about something else. Maybe there is more knowledge about this. And so the people can feel more near the people from Italy. So yeah, I was a bit also embarrassed to hear that maybe some other communities don't feel so welcome as I felt here in Northern Ireland.
Thank you very much. Liz and Melissa had the added advantage that they did come to be part of public achievement, part of WIMPS. So they did have people surrounded them that were going to work with them and going to welcome them. Michael, is there anything we can do to make life better for people that are coming over from other countries?
Yeah, I think there certainly is. In the first place, we need to offer the hand of friendship. And that's a personal act every one of us can undertake. Just welcoming the stranger there beside us and helping them know that they're honoured and welcome and they're an important part of the community. There's a bigger action though. That's just the private individual act that every one of us can do. But I also think we have to come together to fight prejudice and intolerance. Despite the great experiences like yours and that of many others and my own, there are too many people who are suffering unacceptably. We shouldn't have one hate crime in Northern Ireland. And instead we have this astonishing number. And we can say no enough of that by joining together and just crying out from the rooftops that intolerance is totally unacceptable. But you know, there's one other thing as well that I think is really important. We'll treat the new arrivals better when we treat each other better. There are within Northern Ireland also minority groups who suffer really serious prejudice. And I'm not getting into the big issue of sectarian politics and all of that. I'm talking about groups like, let's say, the Travellers. Travellers have been around for hundreds of years, if not more. They suffer extraordinary abuse. A community that says it'll reach out to the new arrivals and still prejudice and discriminates against old communities like the Travellers, it's not going to work. Another group are LGBT. The incidence of homophobic attacks and abuse is rising all the time. And again, a society that tolerates that, it's not going to tolerate the new arrivals either.
To the rest of the panel, do anyone have any comments?
I was actually going to talk about the travelling community in terms of, I feel that, you know, people will turn around and say things, oh, you shouldn't say things that are racist against, you know, people from the African or Asian community or Eastern European community. But I find that there, in society, there's kind of these elements where it's acceptable to be prejudiced against the travelling community. And I think that's totally unacceptable. If we want to be a welcoming, tolerant society, we have to be welcome to everyone, even people who we don't understand. And I think a lot of the time it is misinformation and miseducation about these different groups. I know for a lot of young people who are in the audience today, you know, they're still at school. When I left school, there was hardly anyone from a different minority background from, you know, there was hardly anyone who wasn't from the same kind of background and from the same area I was. And I found that when I talk to the young people I work with now, they've got people from different communities coming through now, because we basically had this last few generations, because, you know, who in the right mind moves to Northern Ireland in the middle of the Troubles, you know? So if you go to cities like Birmingham and London, it's so diverse. Like, you could walk down a street and you would hear about a million different languages and see a million different signs in different languages. And I think that's brilliant. And I just always, you know, find it such a culture shock when you go to places like East London and you come back here and it's just so, it's not as kind of diverse and a melting pot. And I feel that we need to become more welcoming of the melting pot that already exists in a very small way here in terms of the travelling community and the Roma community especially. You hear such abuse in different areas, and I think we have to be, if you see someone, you know, saying something like vaguely racist on Facebook or something against a certain group, you have a duty to turn around and say, if you don't want to tolerate in that society, you have to have the courage to turn around and say, you know, that's not on. And I think it's just the very small individual acts that we can do that can really make a big difference overall to the wider scope of trying to create a more tolerant society here in Northern Ireland.
Thank you. I think I'll start with you, Karen. Do you feel that people coming from other countries to Northern Ireland, do you think to celebrate their diversity, is it feared or is it
celebrated? I, like I said, I think it is a lot about misinformation in terms of it is with a different experience of you're trying to sort out your own situation. It's again as well, if we think about community relations, we automatically think of the two main communities here, but we don't think about the way in which, you know, even within those groups, there are minorities like the LGBT community who don't really get recognition, and you know, all these different kind of, like, you could be from a background where, like, one of your parents is an immigrant, and you know, it's kind of those weird things where there's a lot of misinformation in terms of how people don't know how to take certain groups when they find out if you're a certain identity because of misinformation, sometimes from, like, you know, the tabloid media and things like that. And it's about trying to, I always find that there's always, you can always try and do more research in terms of if you have someone, if you know someone from a different background and things like that. But it's always important to take into consideration that there is this fear that they have, like, if you have a neighbor who's just newly immigrated, there is that fear that they've heard these stories about all these attacks that happen, you know, like you were saying about the couple, the Polish couple. And if you really want to take a stand in your community, you always remember to be welcoming and never feel that if you have a question, I'm sure that the person will be more than likely to happy to answer it in order for everyone to kind of get on more cohesively. Cohesively. And I think that I really think there should be more to be done to, in terms of community relations, should be adopted more to filter in for those different those other minority groups who live here.
Okay, thanks very much, Karen. We're going to pass to Shannon, and Shannon's going to get some.
I have Lucas here from Saintfield, and he has a question, I think.
Yeah, I do, indeed. Do you think that until the divisions within Northern Ireland are fixed, can we truly welcome people from other society, or not? Other societies and other cultures. Can we can't welcome other people first until we can really get along with people who are closest to home. You see what I mean? You know, do you think there is any way to truly welcome? Because there's always going to be xenophobia and racism and things like that.
Do you mean if we can't get on with each other, how can we welcome new people? Yeah, of course. I suppose in a way it's the elephant in the room that we're not talking about here tonight. But when we have a sectarian society, a largely but not totally sectarianized society, a largely but not totally divided community, where it's all separate but equal, we're going to have a real problem. So yes, we have to face that huge social problem in Northern Ireland. At the same time, we can't let new arrivals wait until it's sorted out, but at the same time reach out to them. And that's why I think that that small step that was taken by the government this week announcing some new measures, and they're going to give us more detail apparently tomorrow or next week, it's a good start. But we need a real vision from our government of what a cohesive, shared and integrated society might look like. We're all waiting for that. We've been waiting a long time.
Can I respond to that as well?
Yes,
good. That's a very interesting question, and I think along with what Michael said is new communities can't wait. And I would also throw in there that actually there were communities that migrated to Northern Ireland during the Troubles. The Indian and the Chinese communities are very well settled. They haven't just kind of landed in. but I think one of the problems is that so often with ethnic minority communities in particular is they are getting rights that are only residual to those that are given to the two main communities, rather than adopting more of what we might call a human rights-based culture, which means that everybody's coming up together. So, I mean, I take your point around, you know, how can we deal with, you know, the rights of new communities, so to speak, if we can't handle our own relationships. And I think that's very valid, and I think, you know, we see that all the time. You see issues that aren't your traditional Catholic Protestant getting politicized in that way. You have parties who will oppose things for the sake of it, as far as you can tell on the face of it, oftentimes, anyway. And that's definitely a problem. And I do think that coming at it from a human rights perspective, making sure that rights for ethnic minorities are not residual to the protections that we give to Catholics and Protestants is incredibly important. And for me, that would be a start.
I would just like to comment in that I think that particularly the immigrant community can actually help us become more cohesive, because they don't come with the baggage that we have had through so many generations. So I actually think by allowing different minority groups to have more of a voice, they can actually help benefit overall and help create a more cohesive society, because they don't have that historical baggage that the two main communities have here. And I actually think they can add far more in a positive way to the debate.
Okay.
I have Robert Murda here from the WIMPS West Belfast. He'd like to say something.
I just have a kind of quick statement to make. I want to add a bit of an international dimension to this. I think we've seen immigration has been blamed for a lot of things, not least the economic crisis within Europe. I mean, we've seen the growing kind of far-right groups. I mean, just for example, in Greece, an openly neo-Nazi party has 18 of 300 parliamentary seats. I mean, it's a huge problem. It's more just a statement than a question, but I'm just saying that I think a lot of people, immigrants, are being blamed for the economic crisis, which I don't think is fair and I don't think is right. I think, as we've learned tonight, they contribute a lot to society and economic life within this country and within Europe.
Thank you.
I think it's far easier for people to blame immigrants as why there isn't jobs, because they don't have a proper voice in our society in kind of official capacities. You know, I was heard a story the other day, there was a car washing job in Derry and 1,000-odd people applied for one job. This myth of there's no jobs because the immigrants are taking them is total baloney. Like, the reason there's no jobs is because there's no jobs. And the fact that immigration is being blamed for the financial crisis is totally... The reason the financial crisis happened was a series of mechanisms that were in the financial sector, the high financial sector. You know, it's very easy to turn around and say blame the bankers, but you know, there's a large contributing factor to that. But the reason immigrants are far easier for papers, for people to scapegoat, is because they have no proper real channels to you know, voice their opinions and have real proper spokespeople in this society, unless they become, you know, naturalized citizens. Even as well, the rise of the far right is actually very interesting, especially in Golden Dawn, because their whole kind of basis thing is about blaming immigrants for the problems in the society, because they're easy to scapegoat. You know, you hear stories daily of, you know, Golden Dawn members beating people and, you know, having people come around and check who's citizens, like asking people on the streets to present them in the papers. But I don't think I think that's a way for them to scapegoat the serious situation that we're in. And I'm very glad to say that, you know, the far right hasn't really risen here. Hopefully, you can finish. But the whole thing is that, like you were saying, immigrants have been scapegoated, and it's time we stop this kind of misconception that it's immigrants' fault that people don't have jobs. It's just there's no jobs. That's the real reason of why it happened. And I think when a wider society, we kind of tackle the problem of why there is no jobs, I think that'll kind of bring a bit more understanding of what we need to do to fix our society and this kind of economic mess.
I'm just going to say briefly, a really important thing to keep in mind too is you have your human rights because you're human, not because you're British or you're Irish or you have any citizenship. It's irrelevant. You have it because you're a human being. And so that's just to keep in mind as well. You never need to wait to be a citizen to claim your rights. You can demand them from the moment you're born, wherever you're born.
Okay, thanks very much, guys. We're just going to pass on over to Bruno. Bruno.
To start with, we actually have a shout out to an old WIMPS volunteer, Kelsey. She's the furthest away that we've got so far on Twitter, and she's in Minnesota in America. On Twitter itself, we've had a few interesting questions, things like, do you feel the minority communities are fairly represented in Northern Ireland? Also, we've had a lot of people quote Michael Flaherty in the "We'll treat the new arrivals better when we treat each other better." So there's a lot of following on the minute on the Twitter, with a lot of people telling, you know, to tune in, which is always good. So I would urge anyone in the audience, if you have Twitter, to give us a tweet, especially with your questions. If you're too shy to appear on camera, I'll do it for you.
Okay, thanks very much, Bruna. We're going to go possibly the most controversial topic of the night, which is the flag protests. In December last year, the City Council voted to only fly the flag at City Hall on designated days of the year. Opposed to all year round. This caused, as everyone knows, widespread riots all over Belfast. Robert, would you like to introduce yourself?
Yeah, my name is Robert Murda, and I'm a member of WIMPS West Belfast. Do you want me to expand on my position?
If you like,
My position is very firmly. I think that the decision was taken or was kind of proposed by the Equality Commission to fly the flag on 17 designated days. So it is an issue of equality. I think the stats are there, and I did a bit of homework last night. Approximately the population of Belfast is around 338,000. Of that population, there's about 155,000 from a Catholic community. So that's just under half. So Belfast is a changing city demographically. There's a lot more Catholics, nationalists within Belfast than ever before. Belfast is the capital city of Northern Ireland. It needs to be at the forefront of moving forward as a shared society. So that's my position. I support the Alliance Amendment to fly the flag on 17 designated days because it's an issue of equality. The people, the nationalists, the people who see themselves as Irish in Belfast and in Northern Ireland deserve to be represented as well. And, you know, the thing about it is, we are in the United Kingdom. Whether we like it or not, Northern Ireland is in the United Kingdom. Why do we need a flag to show that? Why do we need a flag to show that? And also, it's not, I mean, I'm going back to very basic arguments, but it's true. The flag isn't flown all year round anywhere else in the United Kingdom. I think it's flown maybe two or three council areas in England, but, you know, very little. So why do we need to fly it here? Why do we need to fly it here? Here is the most kind of politically sensitive area in the United Kingdom. So why do we need to fly it here? Why does it have to rub the flag into nationalist faces?
Okay, thank you. Una, would you like to introduce yourself?
I'm Una and I'm the coach for South Belfast. And just before I get into the flags issue, if I say something that doesn't make sense, it is because I'm exhausted. Just coming before our exam, so I may say stuff that does not make sense. For me personally, the flags decision by the Alliance and the two nationalist parties has made no difference to me whatsoever. Really hasn't. Didn't notice the flag being there, don't notice that it's away, and I really do not see the point in going out into the streets every weekend to protest over something that's not going to change who you are, and it's not going to change who I am or anything like that. You still live where you are, you still can go out and celebrate your culture in whatever way you want. I just don't see what the big deal is, and it's just completely wasting resources that could be used elsewhere.
Thank you.
I'm Paul Robinson, and I'm a member of Progressive Youth, which is the youth wing of the Progressive Unionist Party. I've also been at flag protests myself. I suppose I should preface my remarks by saying I'm neither a spokesperson for the PUP nor for the flag protesters. It's a very broad movement. To come back to your comments, I would say that the taking down of the flag, for me, is a matter of equality, but not of equality of communities. If you look at it that way, I can understand why a nationalist might be upset. But for me, it's about the constitutional status of Northern Ireland. And you have to take into account the broader politics here. The reasons that Sinn Féin gave whenever they were making their arguments was that either there should be no flag flown or there should be both flags flown. And I think whenever you say to them, let's compromise, let's only fly it on 15 days, that was actually presented to us by the Alliance Party as something that we should be happy about, that Sinn Féin actually voted for that, but it's actually part of the problem. Because if they're prepared to be pragmatic about that, the big fear for the last 15 years is, where Sinn Féin being pragmatic in agreeing to the Belfast Agreement? Are they genuine about the principle of consent and Northern Ireland being a part of the United Kingdom? Or was it, in their eyes, a means to an end? So in fact, the very fact that there was that compromise actually fuels some fears on our side.
Thank you, Paul. Alan, would you like to introduce yourself?
Alan Maven, or Alan in Belfast, if I was kind of doing stuff online. I maybe take a different tack as we look at kind of the flags thing. To me, I was sitting in St Albans kind of the night after it happened, and I was sitting kind of watching on Twitter the various kind of tweets coming in from protests, from folk who were disappointed about what had happened, folk who were very happy about what had happened, and trying to kind of piece it together. And it occurs to me that it's a kind of an object lesson in political failure in Northern Ireland. We had large parties wanting to do the kind of things that large parties want to do. So Sinn Féin wanted, having got the new council elected, new councillors, and a kind of an 18-month, two-year project to get the flag down. And you can see that was a large party doing what a large party can do. On the other hand, we had unionist parties who were knowing that that was going to happen and reacting to it by saying, well, we can kind of take a scalp off Alliance as part of this. The timing of it, making sure it happened in Covenant year, the leaflets, you know, those things didn't happen by accident. Now, they may not have been there to provoke the kind of violence and the kind of groundswell of opinion on the street, but I think it's a failure on many parts of actually the kind of leadership, because leadership, certainly within unionism, wasn't actually affecting, it wasn't really representing the people. And at that point, did I say the people? I sound like Jimmy Bryson for a second. But you know, into a vacuum, into a political vacuum, then new leaders, new people, new choreographers, people who could run Facebook, people who could actually stir up the emotion that goes with identity and symbolism. I mean, those are very important things in Northern Ireland. We shouldn't, whether it's a green thing or an orange thing or maybe a yellow thing in the middle, those are, I mean, they get to people's heart. They're kind of issues that people feel deeply about without necessarily being able to articulate why. And I think we ended up on the streets with something that couldn't be stopped. And now we have a kind of a failure again, because we have unionist forums, which are, the unionist forum seems to be a bit of a sop, because it's happening very, very slowly, very underground, difficult to see if anything actually tangible is coming out of it. We have an Ulster People's Forum as the kind of alternative Judean front of forums, and they're, guess what, doing things, but they're not actually connected with the parties in power. And I think it comes down to political failure and the insight to figure out what might happen or what might go wrong.
Thanks very much, Alan. Robert, you would
I just want to say, Paul, you did say about the constitutional status of Northern Ireland, and I did say that myself. The constitutional status of Northern Ireland is firmly as part of the United Kingdom, but I feel to understand why the flag has to be flown. I would not support Sinn Féin and the SDLP in terms of removing the flag completely. I'm very much in favour of the Equality Commission. The constitutional status of Northern Ireland is part of the United Kingdom. Why does the flag have to fly all year round for it to stay like that?
Well, the constitutional status of Northern Ireland is secure, of course, but I would turn the question around. The flag was flying 365 days a year. Why? I mean, if you think about the compromise, it seems to me quite a petty thing. You're saying, okay, we'll let the flag fly 15 days a year just in order to get it down for the other 350. I think in your opening comments you said something about what that flag means to you and about Belfast being having all these different communities in it. If the flag was antagonising you before, how does it help to only have it flying in 15 days? Surely we should get to a point where we recognise the principle of consent and we recognise that the fact that flying the Union flag on City Hall is not meant to intimidate people. It's merely it's quite a normal thing.
Yeah. I'm just going to say, in the past, between 2011 and 2013, there's been 11 pieces of legislation passed in the Assembly, most of which has been conforming to the rest of the United Kingdom. So in keeping with that, you know, the rest of the United Kingdom, their constitutional status is firmly secure. They don't fly it 17 days a year. Why are we any different? By flying the flag 365 days a year, we are being different, which is kind of standing in stark contrast to what you know, unionists and loyalists want.
Do you not think, though, that it's a real shame that the issue that got people angry and the issue that got people out onto the streets to actually, I mean, those were cold. December was cold, and there were people kind of, you know, with cool fingers holding stuff up in the rain, Saturday afternoons, you know, blocking roads, keeping me from driving my car through the roads. But, I mean, to get people to kind of excited to a level that they would actually go out, isn't it a shame that there were a whole lot of other issues that were at least equally important, if not more important, that people could have actually been fired up about and doing something about? And things that actually would have been, it is kind of... it's the week for community relations, but there are things that are cross community, if I can use that word. Things like kind of the education, kind of a needs, things like kind of deprivation levels and poverty, yeah. Things of actually what we dealt with in the previous panel about talking about how newcomers into Northern Ireland are actually treated. Wouldn't it have been great to get a lot more people out on the road or onto the pavements and actually to be angry about that and to actually change society as opposed to doing what was an emotional thing and a very symbolic thing and potentially important to many of the people involved, but actually kind of a second or third order issue compared to actually the community that we would all like to live in. Yeah. And it's kind of all about me on both sides, wanting something down or wanting something up, as opposed to actually wanting to actually make the world a better place for, if you like, the people who don't think like me. So I think that was a missed opportunity to be angry.
I would agree that there is far more important issues to discuss, particularly around the time of December. There is serious issues, the likes of social deprivation, the education system within Northern Ireland. But we can't get away from the fact that this is a huge issue. It matters to a lot of people. In Northern Ireland, there's a lot of people seem very attached to this kind of symbolic politics. I think that it's, speaking to a lot of young people, and I'm from West Belfast, and I'm speaking with a lot of young people who would be from Republican and Nationalist backgrounds, and this is something that they feel very passionately about, no doubt the same in Loyalist and Unionist communities as well. So I agree that there's a lot more kind of bread and butter issues that need to be looked at, but I don't think we can kind of ignore this completely, or else it will just come back in the future to bite us in the butt.
Thanks very much, Robert. Una made a comment earlier about she didn't know that the flag was actually being flown all year round. I myself never noticed the flag was there either. But the real question is, like, where do we go from there? Like, do we just let people protest because the flag comes down? Do we hold another vote to get it back up? Do we take it down altogether?
I can tell you something about what we're doing in Progressive Youth. The PUP have been telling people to politicise. Obviously, voting is important. But for Progressive Youth specifically, there are a lot of people who feel alienated from the politicians who are meant to represent them. And that can be something as simple as not seeing them on the ground, them living in different areas. There's also a feeling that the communities they belong to are stereotyped and scapegoated, or else patronized and manipulated. So we want to give marginalized people a voice, but it's not enough to do that. We also have to create an atmosphere in a society in which those voices are heard and listened to. So one of the things I'd like to come out of this meeting tonight is people asking me, how can we get in contact with you? Would you like to meet up? Because if we just have a 20-minute Q&A session, we all go home, nothing's going to change. We have to start meeting each other, I think. In Progressive Youth, we're also aware that if we're asking people to listen to our voices, we have to listen to other people's voices, not just other communities, but the older generation. Some of the things they've been advising us about are the patterns in history where somebody will agitate for selfish reasons. There'll be an anti-establishment movement that grows up that maybe veers to the right and focuses on a single issue. But whenever those new leaders get into power, maybe they do all the same things over again. So it's the same politics, but with different faces. We don't want to let that happen. We want to, once people are politicized, we want them to think about broader issues in their areas, working class politics.
We're coming up to the time of year where there is the marching season. Mm-hmm. It is quite controversial, even with the flag up. What's anyone's views on that? How is the marching season going to affect the flag protests?
Well, for me, I don't really think that the marching season is really going to have as big an effect as it does. This year is what it would have done in previous years. My point for that being is that when you go into, now not all, but when you go into most loyalist or unionist areas now, every lamppost now has a union flag flying from it, it has bunting, all the curb zones are now being painted that weren't painted before. So, you know, roads that you would have went down in over the marching season, the flags would have been up, and then any other time of the year they would have been down. Now the flags are up all year round, so I think that, you know, we're in a constant sort of a marching season now. You know, for me personally, one of the roads I would go down nearly every day to go to Queens would be the Lower Donegal Road. Literally was fine 2 weeks ago. I came back from holiday and was driving down, and they were out, as I was driving down, painting the curb zones. Every single lamppost has a union flag flying from it. There's bunting going from every lamppost as well, right from Broadway roundabout right down to the City Hospital, and it's a road that everybody uses.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not just in a wee area that, you know, that nobody really goes to. It's a main road
yeah.
in Belfast.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody uses this. It's for intimidation,
yeah.
and for me, the issue isn't the flag at City Hall. It's the flags going up, and not even just the Union flag, the UVF flags.
Yeah.
That's what's the main issue, and for me, the marching season is not going to have
yeah.
the impact that it's had any other year with regard to intimidation with flags, because they're now there all year round.
I think another point just to add on from that is these people who put the flags up, you know, that are up all year round, call themselves loyalists and loyal to the Queen and all the rest of it. I don't know the Queen personally, but I don't think she would really like the fact that there's Union Jacks flying, you know, torn and ripped, and unfortunately that's what happens, do you know what I mean? So to me it's just a contradiction of what they believe in.
I'm from a Protestant area, and where I grew up there would have been flags on the lampposts, there would have been the curbstones painted. They did eventually paint over them just grey, but now like they are being painted red, white and blue again. The scene when Una said there about intimidation, you shook her head there. Like, being from a Protestant area, I wouldn't like to walk in or walk down Donegal Road.
Lower Donegal Road.
And I would feel quite intimidated, and that's being from a Protestant background.
Okay, well I think that to bring us back to the City Hall decision. I think what that did was to reinforce the message that that there was something intimidatory about the flag, whenever you said yourself that you didn't even notice it. So that decision has put that message out there, and it has also made people defensive. I last summer I was on an archaeology dig, and I dug in a Philistine city. The interesting thing about the Philistines is if you look at the site, the number of pig bones increases over time. Obviously, they were on the border with Israel at the time, so it was like an ethnic marker.
Yeah.
So, of course, once you have conflict between communities, they're going to feel the need to put up those ethnic barriers or ethnic markers to preserve their identity, to say
yeah.
that we're here and we're proud of this.
And that's the problem this summer, because we're going to interpret and. What might be a normal marching season, we're going to interpret it through the eyes of, I wonder, is this related back to the flag thing? So every little kind of diversion in Portadown, every kind of march that becomes sensitive, will be extra sensitive because we're waiting to see, is this going to be fueled by flags or not?
Yeah.
And that's the dangerous thing. It may just be like a normal year, but it may not, because we'll actually think it into
yeah.
being an abnormal year.
Yeah.
And I think that's where we're very unstable. And I think, given the political instability of the larger parties are not actually necessarily representing the folk who feel the identity crisis the most, then that makes it kind of quite wobbly. It'll be interesting to see how things go.
Thanks very much. This is such a quite controversial subject that people are obviously going to have questions and comments. So we're going to go to Shannon, who I believe has someone waiting.
Yeah, I'm here with Carl, who is a member of the East Belfast WIMPS crew that is just formed, and you have a few points to
say.
Robert
said there about rubbing the flag in the nationalist faces. I don't know what you mean by that, because Irishmen went to the First World War and fought numerous wars for Britain and fought and died for the Union flag. And this one is the UNA. You said about the UVF flags. The UVF flags wasn't for the League of Poor Military, it was for the UVF who went and fought in the Somme. So I don't know how that's intimidation.
it's intimidation, because I'm sure you would know, and anybody in the room would know, that the obvious association with the UVF is the UVS that was present around the Troubles. And it may not have been for that UVF, I grant your point there, but the fact is that those flags were actually given permission to be up over that commemoration period and were supposed to be taken down, and still months later have not been taken down. So fair enough, if you want to put them up, you've got permission to put them up and it's for a commemoration, go ahead. I don't care if people want to fly flags from their houses, from their windows. It's public property, it's taxpayers' property. It doesn't belong to one community or the other. And the obvious association, again, with the UVF is the ones that were present through the Troubles. And especially with my generation, who maybe doesn't go back that far with regards to the original UVF, and even the older generation, some people may not realise that. But the main points are that those flags were supposed to be taken down months ago, and they're still flying there, and it is a form of intimidation. Whether people mean it that way or not, they know that's the way it comes across to the other side. And also as well, I'm also against the increased number in tricolours going up in nationalist areas, because I don't want to be living in any sort of area that has a flag marking out who I'm supposed to be.
Yeah, and just to take up on the point about many Irishmen who fought for Britain in the First World War. I don't want to give kind of a history lecture, but I'm sure a lot of historians will tell you that most of the men, certainly a good number of the men who fought for the British Army in World War I, and in fact, my great-grandfather actually fought in World War I on behalf of Britain. A lot of those men fought, particularly from the South, fought because they were told that if Irish men did get involved with the British Army, that there would be a greater chance of Home Rule being passed after the war was over. And of course, you went to 1916 and the East Rising and all the rest of it. But also as well is you had many men who believed that if they went into the British Army, that they would stop being kind of abused and assaulted by British Army in Ireland at the time, and also it was a steady wage and a secure kind of job, even though they were sent on behalf of the British of Britain. They were sent into the Battle of the Somme, which most people will know was a suicide mission, and it was deliberately sent Irish volunteers into.
But I mean, to go back to your flag thing, while people are afraid, which just kind of means while they're not being listened to and feel that they're actually part of a community or part of a society that actually values them, then symbolism will be really important. And flags are a really symbolic thing. It's a really simple symbol. And that's why flags on all sides will be kind of either to get them up, to keep them down, to kind of get them in the middle. It's just going to be a big issue. It's a very simple thing. Curbs are a very easy way too. And it's going to be so hard for people to actually trust each other and be generous with let's not make flags an issue. I just can't see people getting over that at the moment.
Yeah, and just again, just on what I was saying. I mean, that's a valid point, and I've said all that about the time as well. But let's be very clear. There's been about 100 years, 100 years in 2012. Since then, of Irish history has changed, and Irish history throughout the past 500 years has changed. It's been like a pendulum. It's swung back and forward.
It's so 40, 100, 400, 3800. Good history.
No, it's exactly. You know, so it's times have changed, and we have history has changed since then.
To have another wee point to make. Sinn Féin and Alliance and the SDLP should have realised the consequences it was going to cause, especially after the marching season before, with all the determinations the Pruitt Commission made.
Yeah, and again on that, I'm just saying I agree with you there that they knew that they probably, I don't know if they knew the extent of the consequences, but it's a case of, I think that Sinn Féin, SDLP and the Alliance, I mean, aren't going to be intimidated in what is an issue of equality. They're there to do a job, and their job is to represent their constituents. I don't think they would have taken into consideration in terms of their final decision, because that would have been given in to kind of threatening behaviour. So
I think also you need to. I also come from West Belfast as well. So one thing one thing that I've noticed, which may not be obvious to the unionist community, is that the way the nationalists are looking at it, you know, the unionist community are looking at it that Sinn Féin, the SDLP and the Alliance took away their culture and took away their identity by taking down the flag. Nationalists are looking at it that the SDLP and Sinn Féin and Alliance voted for the flag to fly when they weren't supposed to. So, you know, both communities aren't happy with the decision. So it is about respecting each other. And it was, you know, for me, as I said at the start, I don't care whether the flag's there or not. I don't notice it if it's there and I don't notice if it's not. And I just don't really see why people have to waste their time talking over a piece of cloth. And I would say that about the tricolour as well. If it was the tricolour being put up or put down, it doesn't make a difference to me. It is just a flag. And, you know, everybody has their view, but at the end of the day, the parties here can't win, because if one side wins, the other side loses. And if the, and this is a classic example of them trying to find, you know, for once trying to find a solution that was in the middle, and again, nobody's happy.
Okay. Paul, any comments?
You said there about it just being a piece of cloth. It's a piece of cloth that so many people's fought and died for.
No, I understand that. That's your view, and that's my view. I don't see the point in fighting and arguing over a flag, and that's any flag. I'm not just saying it about the Union flag. Any flag, I don't see what's worth people fighting and falling out over it.
Well, again, I would say at the start I said I thought it was a matter of equality in a sense, but I didn't explain myself actually. I think for us it's a matter of the principle of consent. Are Republicans serious about the principle of consent? Do they recognise that are they happy to say that the future of Northern Ireland rests in the hands of Northern Irish people? And it's the principle of consent is founded on the principle of equality of individuals. So think back to at the start of the Troubles when you had the civil rights movement. Gusty Spence, to take one example, went, served in the British Army, came back to the Shankill, he didn't have a vote. His neighbours in the Falls didn't have a vote either. Through great struggle, everybody was given a vote. And now, in 2013, 15 years after the Good Friday Agreement, to say that you should take down the Union flag because it offends people and because we want either no flag or both flags flying, to us shows an element of bad faith in how you've went about implementing the Good Friday Agreement.
But you should also be allowed a democratic decision. You should be allowed a protest.
Yeah.
But neither of them should get out of hand.
Yeah,
and that's where we failed. It wasn't because we tried to do it, but I think you need to move on.
Okay. We're going to move to Bruna and see what's happened on Twitter.
Yep, just before we go to the audience. Yeah, I actually have a question here that would be quite good for the audience to debate, because a lot of us here today are young people. It's from Stephen, and it says, does any young people agree with me that Northern Irish is an identity on its own with unique culture and symbols? So instead of just, you know, being bogged down on the Union Jack or the Irish tricolour, you know, is there a way that Northern Ireland, like, is it a Northern Irish identity? Do any of you feel, you know, it is an identity but it's not recognised, or if it is, how can we, you know, get it improved and actually recognised? So, questions on that before I keep reading out tweets or anything? No? Okay. Actually, have one that is, it's on a lighter note and it's kind of taken away. I know a lot of the times here, like, we have quite a funny sense of humour in Northern Ireland. But there's one here from Maeve, and it's just saying, on a lighter note, I want to know where the unionist stroke loyalist community get the massive flags from. # Super King duvet cover. Which is quite, because they are quite big, if anyone.
Let's hope they're made in Northern Ireland.
And you know, there's a lot of comments coming in about how you know, we're doing, and the live cast itself is going quite well for anyone that's watching out there. There's also a few questions here about hearing a lot of history here, isn't the future more important? Shouldn't it be one nation going forward? So anyone, any questions from the audience?
Does anyone have any statements they want to put out? Here, your language.
I think the politicians should aim for a shared future. That's in my opinion, because the history is the past. We're looking forward to the future. That's my opinion. So.
Okay.
Any other opinions?
Thanks I wouldn't much. Say that I'm Northern Irish, or I wouldn't classify that as my identity or anything, but I do think there should be a shared flag just to represent both sides. I mean, Scotland and Wales both have their own flag and they're part of the United Kingdom, so it should be the same for us.
I think until we have integrated education, we're not going to have Northern Irish shared vision or future. So I think it has to start with young people in education together.
Do you think that with an integrated education, I'm assuming that you would be for it because it would bring us together, but what about those times when it doesn't? Do you think that could happen, that it could just not work?
I think for these young people's children, when they're up and have their own children, then that's when, it's for the next generation. This generation, I don't know, we're just going to have to deal with it as we go.
Okay, thank you. And is there anybody else who has anything they want to put forward?
Well, thanks very much. Moving on from the flag protest, we're now coming to a panel that's going to talk about how young people are portrayed in the media. A lot of young people were portrayed badly in the media because of the flag protests. Then you have the likes of Paris Brown, who was Britain's first youth police and crime commissioner, who was stepped down from her post for tweets that she had sent one or two years prior to having her post. I'm just going to ask the panel to introduce themselves briefly, and then we'll start a discussion.
My name's Carl, and I'm in East Belfast WIMPS, and we've only just started, so this is all new to me at the minute. So.
My name's Phil Murray. I'm a member of the Royal WIMPS crew. I've been at WIMPS for about 9 months now.
I'm Kathleen Homeland, and I'm just thinking, I wish I could have also been on the first panel, because when you're talking about identity, I was born in Italy, I grew up in Italy, quindi parlo italiano. My mother's from Belfast, from East Belfast, and my father's from New York State, and I've lived in 5 different countries and I speak 4 languages. So identity for me is something kind of different from, you know, what I come across here. But I just wanted to state something that I've discovered in my journey around identity, and that is that I don't define myself by external factors. We all get to define our own identities. And we all get to define culture and community and play an active role in that. We're not defined by it, at least that's my belief.
Thank you.
My name's Orla Hendren. I'm the development worker for an organization called Here and I. We work with lesbian and bisexual women. And I'm also a board member for the International Gay and Lesbian Youth and Student Organization.
Thanks very much. Coming back to the whole Paris Brown incident, where she was stepped down from her post for tweets that she had sent 1-2 years prior. I know myself and Shannon had a discussion about how people changed so much over the last 2 years. How do you think, like, the media jumped on this, as in she was brought up she was in the youth police and fire crime commissioner, or police and crime commissioner, the youth, or the media jumped on this and really put her down. How do you think the media portray young people?
I think in the Paris Brown situation, the media were almost savage about the way they approached it. They had to go back 2 years to find tweets, which I think may have been taken out of context. The words that she used, I'm not condoning what she said or anything, but the words that she was using was not probably the view that they would be used in Northern Ireland on the rest of the world. It was sort of like the way in colloquial dialect, words get changed and means vary. And I think that was just a misinterpretation. I don't think she was trying to portray the image that was interpreted.
I mean, the other thing you have to remember is this is a very young girl who made those comments. And I work for a gay rights organization, and some of the things that she said came across as homophobic, but we have to remember that this is a completely different society. Young people are growing up in now. I didn't have the internet whenever I was 13 or 14. I expressed my views to a very small group of friends. Young people now have a massive group of friends on the internet, and they're trying to find their identities, trying to express themselves, and they're doing it all through social media, and it's all recorded. I would probably die off on this stage right now if people had recorded half the things that I thought and said at the age of 12, 13, or 14. So, I mean, I think Paris Brown was very much made an example of, and we were talking about it earlier. And of course, there's always a reason to make an example of somebody. But I think they could have done it a lot better. She could have been, you know, educated a wee bit on social media, how to use it. I know from the comments that she gave when she actually resigned, she wasn't asked to resign, but she resigned because of the pressure. And this is a young 16-year-old girl, you know, representing our country in the police commission, or representing all young people, really, in the police commission. And the treatment that she got, I think, was 100% unfair, especially when you take into consideration some of the things that our politicians, our actual elected politicians, say on the same topics. So I really think she was treated very, very badly.
I would agree sort of on the bad treatment, 100%. Having said that, we were just discussing this at the same time. There's a part of me that sort of sees, well, it's kind of good to have an example, unfortunately for her, to young people to recognize how careful you have to be online and what you say, and really the power of words and words in general. And unfortunately, they often do get taken out of context. But I think in some respects for many of, you know, the young people here today, it's to look at that and think, okay, I've got to think twice before I post that thing on my social media platform, and just think, is this really going to be a little bit out of line? Should I post it on a public one? Should I put it just on my own private social platform? And just, you know, think twice.
The other question around that as well is, how many young people really heard about that? You know, we're talking about making an example of somebody and sending a message, but, you know, when I was 14, I didn't read the news. You know, I still don't read the news. I don't think it's boring. So, you know, I don't know exactly how many young people that might have reached in terms of, okay, we'll make an example of her. We'll send a message to everyone. We sent a message to all the adults who read the news and who hounded on it. But for all the young people who are still writing stuff like that on their Facebook pages and on their tweets, you know, I don't think that message really reached even half of them. So it's interesting that they made an example of her, when realistically what they should be doing is providing better education around social media, or just the media in general.
Yeah, I think Paris as well was treated unfairly, because I know for myself that I've tweeted a few things that I have regretted and I have deleted because of what I have tweeted and the people who are on my Twitter. So I think she just been, should have given a second chance, and like she said, sorry, you know, and that should have been enough to everyone. But
I know for WIMPS, social media is such a big thing, because we use social media for all of our events. If you're tweeting on Facebook, we put a lot of things online on WIMPS.tv. Do you think that young people are misusing social media?
I think it's unfair just to brand the young people as misusing social media, because if you look at some of the things footballers and even politicians, as you were saying, post up, they can get really offensive on. Other than a brief note in the news, nothing really happens to it. Whereas in the Paris Brown case, she lost it. She resigned from her job because of it.
Yeah, I mean, those people are setting the example for our young people. So if you're not trained or you haven't been educated in school around the media and social media, I mean, kids now are taught what to think, not how to think. So they're not being very critical about what they're saying or what they're hearing. So when politicians and celebrities like footballers say things, and they're role models for everybody, it's very easy for young people to misconstrue that as being okay. The other side of it is a lot of young people coming through school might not necessarily be challenged on the views that they have, because, well, not least because some schools are, I mean, she made some homophobic comments. At least in Northern Ireland, schools are exempt under Section 75, so they don't have to do anything about that. So kids, young people, sorry, I keep saying kids, go the whole way through school, possibly being homophobic, maybe not meaning to, and not being challenged on it, and then at the age of either 16 or 18, leaving school, find themselves in the world of work where everything's challenged, everything that you've just known, everything that you've ever said throughout your whole entire school life in your own social circles is now straight away, the next day, not okay. And I don't think we're doing a really good service for our young people when we send them out into the world undereducated or miseducated about what's socially acceptable when it's been socially acceptable for their whole lives up until that point. Does that make sense?
Comments on it? I know that I don't watch the news. I walk into WIMPS and count on Shannon coming in shocked or bewildered on something that that showed up on the news. So I didn't know about the Paris Brown incident until we had Curry. I was also quite shocked to find out that social media, or young people are using social media not only to arrange the flag protest, but to arrange like where they're going to meet, what they're going to do, what's going to happen around that. Any comments on like young people, the way they were portrayed by the media during the flag protests?
I think it was interesting the way they were blaming, you know, being a sort of social media whatever specialist or communication specialist and everything, how they easily were blaming social media for all this stuff, and you're kind of like, really, it's not the platform's issue here. And also the fact that actually the fact that they would have been using something like Facebook or Twitter, those are public platforms, so essentially that can also be more easily policed. It's more text messaging and things that are done secretly that can't really be seen as taken care of. So I'm actually still not sure as to how exactly they used the social media platforms to all meet up in a place and, you know, at a particular time without, you know, the PSNI knowing that this was taking place. So, you know, I think it's very often, obviously, the young people are demonized and the platforms are demonized when really it's kind of, you know, it's an easy scapegoat to sort of use these elements when really they're not the issues at stake there. So,
yeah. I mean, on the other side of it as well, I mean, if you take away, I mean, we're all jumping on this flag thing, of course, it's a controversial issue. If you take away the issue, the very fact that those young people mobilized themselves, regardless of what it was about, they were activists, they got up, they got in touch with each other, and they met up, they actually got on the streets. That doesn't happen here, that doesn't happen anywhere, and it actually happened. So, you know, whilst it is a controversial issue, that it's a method of best practice, really, for young people. If they see an issue in their society, jump on Facebook, tweet about it, check out other people's tweets, get excited, get aggravated, regardless of what the topic of your aggravation is. You know, I think it's brilliant what they did. I don't necessarily agree with the violence and everything else that happened around that, but the very fact that that came from mostly young people, they weren't directed by anybody else, they did it themselves, I think is a credit to them, if I can say that without being too controversial.
Mm-hmm. But the young people being betrayed during the flag protests, I know from personal experience, I was walking up Dentmore Avenue just in East Belfast there, me and my friend, and a police car pulled us in. We were coming back from McDonald's and started to ask us all these questions just because protests were going on.
Yeah. And you were young. That's why, you know, you're young.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
I think young people have a bad rap anyway. You know, even me, if I'm walking down the street and I see two young people coming towards me, regardless of what they're wearing, but if they're walking towards me, I immediately feel, as much as I try and stop myself, a wee bit intimidated, and I don't know why, but realistically, I do know why. It's because of how they're portrayed to us. You know, I automatically think, right, this is two hoodies and I'm going to get some abuse here. When realistically, they just walk on past, maybe ask you for a lighter and say, thanks, love. Do you know what I mean? So it's this fear of, I think there's a real fear mongering around young people, especially in the media. And we really have to try and step away from that. And we're not going to be able to step away from it unless we have young people involved in the media. So, you know, media training for them, media schools for young people, get them when they're young, get them in education. They need to be involved because those ideas are being portrayed by adults. You know, young people aren't going around saying, everybody's a hoodie, don't talk to us when we're passing you. Do you know what I mean? They're not saying that themselves, it's adults. And realistically, it's probably jealous adults who used to be walking down the street being afraid, or having people be afraid of them, or having people at least giving them that respect. So, you know, I think young people should take back the media, really, which I guess was this all about. So.
Yeah, that's great. I think that education for young people around the use of social media is something that needs to be focused on. Since there is a big social media, do you want to move to Shannon and hear what's happening on Twitter and comments from the audience?
Yeah, we'll go to Twitter first. What's happening?
There's been a lot of people quoting what Orla said on Twitter there about, if I can find it again, yeah, young people are now taught what to think, not how to think, which is quite interesting to come to, like, to look at here. A lot of the young people that are involved in WIMPS, like, we come to WIMPS and it's a case of it's your voice that's allowed to be heard. We're not told what to do or how to think. We may be told where to stand and how to use the equipment and stuff. But at the same time, we're told, you know, how to think for ourselves. It's quite interesting. There's been a lot of people actually quoting it on Twitter. That's come up a lot. There's a lot of comments as well about Paris Brown, to take, like, for her actions when she was 14. And like one of you said, that when, like, I know if I rightly, when I was 14, I wouldn't have wanted people to be tweeting what I was saying, because a lot of it was rubbish.
Yeah.
And just, we've gone back to now a few things, like, people are talking about the motivation as well, and what you were saying there about how it was actually, although they don't agree with what happened during the flags protest, a lot of people have been saying it was really good to see, you know, young people actually motivated to get onto the streets about a topic. What happened afterwards wasn't what they agree with, but the fact that we were getting young people motivated in society and the use of social media was quite good. So that's Twitter. Anything else?
Thanks very much, Bruna. Any comments from the audience?
I actually have a question. Do you think the reports and the scrutinism of Paris Brown's tweets will affect how young people get jobs now? Because inevitably, you know, we will be affected, if you get me. You know, do you think that's something that will still happen, even though that many people aren't really thinking about Paris Brown anymore?
We all have to worry about this. You know, digital footprints are just the nature of the game now. We all, more or less, if we're on any of these platforms, we have a digital footprint, and we always have to be careful. So I think, you know, the element is that each and every one of us is under scrutiny, and you always have to and you always have to keep that in mind whenever you do anything online or anything that could be appearing. And, you know, that's one thing that I'm always conscious with, and I even do some coaching with this, is just looking at your, making it a habit to look at, you know, Google yourself and look at your digital footprint, because increasingly employers are looking at, you know, I think that it's over 50% now of employer, you know, that they'll go and check you out if you've applied for a job, that they will go online to see what you're up to. Not necessarily to see what bad things you're up to, but actually just think yourselves what, especially those of you that are involved in WIMPS, you know, these things are going to help you to show your activity, to show your engagement in community, and to build that up, because it will help actually, you know, use it as a tool to assist you in your career, in a sense, by making sure you put good stuff up yourself and be involved in initiatives that will get that digital footprint sort of expanded for the better. So I wouldn't necessarily see it. Sure, there's always going to be negatives, but there's tons of positives as well. And the great thing is nowadays, you know, we have the availability and the tools that can be learned reasonably quickly for us ourselves to have our voices heard online and have some level of control over what we say, at least.
What's the best way to look at our digital footprint to see what we're saying online? What's the best way to take, I don't know what way I'm trying to word this, to censor what we're saying?
I mean, I don't think people should be advised to censor what they say. It's just, you have to remember who you're saying it to. It's different. People are entitled to their opinions regardless of what they are. I'm entitled to mine, you're entitled to yours. We might not necessarily agree, And that's okay. In fact, that's actually the best part about society, that we don't all have the same opinion. Otherwise, it'd be boring as hell. But realistically, you have to remember who you're saying it to. When you're sitting on Facebook, you might be sitting in your bedroom or on your phone at school at the lunch break with a couple of friends, and then you write something, you all have a giggle about it. But is your Facebook page private? Mm-hmm. Do you know your privacy settings? Can anybody come and look at your Facebook page? If 20 of your friends like that post, can 20 of their friends then see it? And 20 of their friends, and 20 of their friends, not just see it, but share it. And that can be traced right back to you. The other thing is what we were just talking about. It's already happening. Employers are firing people because of the things they say on Facebook. And that's largely happening because, you know, I work in a gay rights organization. If I didn't, and somebody in my organization wrote something that was homophobic and I'm their friend on Facebook, I immediately feel intimidated at work. So what's my sense of redress? What do I do? Do I go to my manager, my line manager, and say, well, actually, I feel uncomfortable working in partnership with this person because of the views they've had on Facebook? They're immediately outed as having said something controversial or prejudiced on their Facebook page that they might think is private, but realistically it's not, you know? So we have to remember who we're speaking to. I don't believe in censoring anybody, but just, I think it's around education. Young people are not taught, nobody has been taught how to use social media. People are finding out now, it's a relatively new phenomenon, but just bear in mind who you're talking to. You're not just talking to your mates.
Thanks very much. Back over to Shannon.
Yep, we have Paul Robinson here from Progressive Youth.
Hi, this is my first experience of WIMPS, and I think it's excellent. And I just want to tell you a story about something that happened to me 3 or 4 weeks ago. The PUP launched a document on reconciliation. I was on the 3-man panel for that, representing Progressive Youth. In Progressive Youth, we talked about the document and we prepared a little statement. I put about 2 weeks' work of research into it. I was very nervous. At the media launch, there was TV crews, there was newspaper reporters. Not one of them asked me a question. I did make a statement afterwards. Nobody reported it. So it struck me as quite ironic that these people were writing about how the Protestant working class felt alienated. They were writing about the youth in the protests, and yet whenever we wanted to make a statement on reconciliation and to reach out, that message was totally ignored. So I think events like this are very important, and social media is also very important.
Thank you. Is there anybody else?
Hi, I just snuck back here. I think this discussion on social media is really, really interesting, particularly when you're touching on, is this going to impact on our professional lives? Yes, I've seen it happen. But the other thing that I wanted to raise, and I think Orla touched on this briefly, is this idea of harm. You know, I think it's one thing to say that nobody should be censored, and in theory I agree with you on that, but I think that it needs to go beyond, can people see what I'm saying? To how is what I'm saying impacting on people that I can't even see, that I might know, that I might be hurting in some way. And I don't think that's censorship. I don't know what the real word, for lack of a better word off the top of my head, is decency, really, and empathy. So I just want to throw that out there to the panel to think about as well.
I 100% agree with you there. It's around awareness, you know, there's this, I keep referring back to the gay thing, but it's where I work, it's what I do. But there's this phrase going around, that's so gay. And I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but I myself have used it, and I know that most people in this room probably, if they haven't used it, have heard it being used and not said anything. Things like that go around social media all the time. Not just that, it's everything that you say has an impact on somebody. And again, it relates back to who you're talking to, who knows about it, and how's that going to make them feel. You might have a friend sitting there who feels that you've said something directly about them, that they now feel alienated, not just from you, but possibly from Facebook in general. They don't want to be there, and then they lose out on that sort of really important social media. It's a brilliant point. Thanks for making it, actually.
On? Oh yeah, it is now. I just heard my voice. And I think this sort of brings us back to very fundamental human principles and this element that, you know, we all have our human rights, but with our rights come responsibilities. And we have to, you know, yes, we take ownership for our rights, but we also have to take ownership for our responsibility for our actions and our words and what impact they have on other people. So I think all this is a lesson to just, you know, see that we do live in communities, and if our actions and words are gonna, you know, hurt or have impact, we also, you know, we have to take that into consideration and take responsibility for that and not just use it as attacking language. So.
Just going back to the point that you were saying about how when you were trying to make a statement about reconciliation that was ignored, I believe that the whole media perspective and perception of young people is completely warped, because it never notices or gives young people recognition for the good work they do in their communities. As part of a youth forum that raised over £1,000 for a new youth centre in Portadown, and we got a one-page mention in a local newspaper, and other than that, there was no mention at all. And I mean, like, it's things like that. The media will jump all over stories like the Parish Brown incident, but they're not willing to recognise the good work that young people do in their communities. And me and Robert were talking about this before this discussion. Like, media are there to sell stories more than to give objective views.
Yeah, I think you're fine. I mean, in general, I know it's easy to say also that they object, you know, they demonize the youth, but in general, the media doesn't really tell good, nice stories about nice people. I mean, it's just, yeah. Whatever age you are, it's not usually going to make news. And I think partially, I mean, I think that the, you know, what WIMPS is doing is terrific, and I know there's increasing, you know, there's sort of two sides. There's the work that you do in lobbying to ensure better coverage in media and use of social media and that stuff that you do, you know, within policy framework to change that. And then there's the stuff that, you know, WIMPS is doing and other groups are doing, which is creating the good content, creating the nice stories. I mean, there's Tell It in Colour here in Belfast. There's, you know, they have a publication down south, I think, called The Champion or something.
Okay.
So it's, again, looking at, you know, so there's ways of, okay, let's start telling the good stories and the more positive learning stories, as well as, you know, pushing those buttons and asking for better coverage and trying to ensure that.
And that's why social media is so important, because it's not run by, you know, the media per se. It's run by the people who are on Facebook. And Paul, just going back to what you said, you know, it's so typical that in running stories or content on alienation of young people, particularly from your sector of society, it's very, very typical that they then alienated them, if you know what I mean. So there's no way around that. The media is all about sensationalism. It's all about controversy, and that's the only thing that grabs people's attention. But that's not, I don't know if that's necessarily true, but it's the only thing that's out there right now. But Facebook and Twitter and all those other things are changing that. They're starting to change that, where I don't know how, and sometimes I get annoyed at it, but all these positive affirmations on Facebook, all these great stories, all this great news, all these people doing these massive campaigns, raising money for kids with cancer, raising money for everything, and it's all over the internet, it's all over social media, and it's only going to get bigger, you know, and print media is going to be, you know, defunct before long. We'll still have the television, but, you know, most people are watching TV shows on the internet, where it's a free-for-all for everybody. So, you know, my advice really for young people is get online. If you're doing something good in your community, make a video about it, write a blog about it, promote it on Facebook, do what you can to get that message out there. Because as a young person, it's very hard to be yourself if you can't see yourself. And if you're a good young person, which most, actually all young people are inherently good, then, and they're doing good things, it's very hard to be that good person if you don't see it in the media, when all you see is bad stuff. It's very hard. You feel like maybe you're the exception to the norm by being a decent human being. And it's like, what kind of a warped message are we sending to everybody, not just young people? So get online, tell your stories, grab your identity, and shove it in people's faces if you want. That's what the internet's for.
Great. Thanks very much. That brings us to the end of tonight, guys. Just want to say thank you to everyone that's been on all the panels. Now everyone's here. Thanks everyone for coming. Thanks everyone for tweeting. Thanks for all the production staff who's put tonight together. Yeah, that's us. Thanks for coming. Thank you.